I went to a yard sale last weekend, and I didn't get much, but I did get a couple things which I think are worth sharing in this video. First thing I got for $1 is this Optimus portable CD player with built-in AM-FM radio tuner. It's from the year 2000, manufactured August 2000, and it included the original Radio Shack AC adapter. But unfortunately, it doesn't work. On the FM radio tuner, it has weak reception. It picks up just the strongest local stations. The AM tuner picks up nothing but static, and the CD player doesn't work at all. So I'm not quite sure what's wrong with it. At least I only paid $1 for it, and I got the AC adapter, which does work, and it has this detachable tip. Originally, it would come with a whole set of these with different sizes, but unfortunately, I only have this one size here, but it is swappable between positive tip and negative tip, depending on which way you plug it in. So that's handy to have. Also for $1, I got this Johnny Cash record. I would love to play some of this for you, but I'm sure I would get copyright claims if I even attempted to play just a few seconds of it. It's in very good condition. It's the stereo version. This was released in 1969, and I noticed this sticker on it, special sale, $2.99. Now, assuming this may have been from 1970, let's say, I put that into the inflation calculator. That comes out to the equivalent of $20 in today's money. So if you see records selling today for around $20, that's not really that much more expensive once you consider inflation compared to what they were almost, well, exactly 50 years ago. But that's only really directly comparable if average wages had kept pace since then, and unfortunately they have not. But I just thought that was interesting seeing that price tag on that. And more interesting for this video are these two records I got, also for $1 each. This first one, it's a 10-inch in diameter record. It feels like a 78. I think this is shellac, but it could be very thick vinyl. And you notice both sides of the label are completely blank. So I don't know what is recorded on this. Clearly has grooves on both sides, so something's recorded on it. This side has A1 etched into it, so I assume that's the first side, and the other side says A2, so that's probably the second side. So I'm gonna take a listen to this, see if there's anything good on it. Assuming it's 78 RPM, but you never really know. And also this record here, it's an audio disc from Audio Devices Incorporated, Madison Avenue, New York. You know, it's got to be leased from the early 60s or older because it doesn't have a zip code. It says New York 22. From the makers of audio tape, and they have a picture of a reel of tape there. It's 12 inches in diameter. Feels like vinyl, but a little bit thicker than your typical vinyl these days. And you notice these extra holes? That's to keep it firmly on the platter while it was recording so it wouldn't slip. But you can see it's a recording blank, and the title says Lofen Christmas 1956 by Fitz. I think they meant Fritz Herbert. Recorded at 78 RPM, 33 RPM. I guess you were supposed to check off or circle one of those, and they didn't, so I don't know. It could be either 78 or 33 and a third. Outside in or inside out. Because some of these, the stylus would start in the middle and travel to the outside. So it'll be a surprise as to which one of those this one is. Here's the other side. A trick on the piano. Misspelled, and also they didn't check off or circle which one it is on this side either. So I'm definitely interested to hear what's on these mystery records. Since you can tell I believe in only using the highest quality audio and video components, I pulled out my Crosley Collegiate record player. I already installed the special 3mm tip on it for playing 78s. And this does have 78 RPM speed on it. So I'm ready to go with playing the first side of this mystery unlabeled record. set to 78 RPM, which I think is the most logical speed for a record like this. So let's go. Kind of big band. It's a very muffled sounding recording. I don't know if it was possibly recorded from the radio or something, or just a poor quality live recording. Let's just skip towards the end, see if there's some kind of announcement or something at the end of the recording. No, it just ends. So here we go with the second side of this mystery record. Another very muffled sounding big band recording. Bad performance of whatever this band is, just a poor quality recording. So let me jump to the end again. Again, it just ends. And here we go with the audio disc recording blank of Fitz Herbert playing Lofen in Christmas 1956. I'm going to let this one run all the way through because I know it's a homemade recording, if I can find the spindle. It's kind of confusing because you see more than one hole, but there it goes on the center. And here we go. Thank you. I think I could hear some people talking at the end there, but they are too quiet to make out what they are saying. And this side is a trick on the Pianio by Fitz Herbert, Christmas 1956. This side actually has some narration on it, so I connected it to my computer, and I'm going to do a direct hookup recording of this and try my best to clean up the sound, so you'll hear the improved version of the audio on this recording.
There was a little girl by the name of Mary who had been taking piano lessons for maybe 2 or 3 months. And she learned to play a song called Keep the Home Fires Burning like this. So Mary had a little brother, Johnny, who was taking from a different teacher. And he had been taking lessons 4 months. And he learned to play a song. There's a long, long trail of winding, which went like this. Papa was home, there was only one piano. So when Johnny wanted to practice, Mary wanted to practice. And when Mary wanted to practice, Johnny got angry. So they were always having big arguments and everything, till one day Mother came in and she heard them. So she said, "What's the matter, children?" And they told her. So she laughed and said, "Well, Johnny, you play your song up here. And Mary, you play yours down here. But do it at the same time." So they did, and this is what it sounded like. Taking piano lessons for several years, and Mary got so she could play a song called Jealous, which went like this. But Johnny got way ahead of Nola, of Mary rather. He could play Nola. But when they play together, it still sounds on one piano like this.
Turns out this name actually is supposed to be Fitz instead of Fritz, because I found a YouTube video of a 78 of him playing the Savoy Boogie, his own composition, on the Savoy record label, a famous jazz record company. But I looked up the catalog number of that record on 78 Discography, and it shows it as unissued, but the date range of that record is in 1942, which was near the very beginning of that record label. So he may have been one of the founding members of Savoy Records. As for Fitz himself, the only thing I found that could possibly be relating to him is an obituary for someone named Ernest Hayward Fitzherbert, who was born in Morristown, New Jersey in 1923 and passed away at age 91. And it says he played the organ and piano. So it's possible that Mr. Fitzherbert used Fitz Herbert as his stage name when he was performing.